Welcome to lecture 4 of module 1 on 8051 microcontroller, in which we will be discussing about the internal RAM 8051 pin diagram in detail. In case of 8051 architecture, we have 128 byte RAM. We have 128 bytes of RAM. So the address ranges from 00 to FF. So the total address range for RAM, internal RAM of 8051 is ranging from 00 to FF. So out of this, the first four bytes, that is 0 to 7, the address range 0 to 7, 8 to 0F, 10 to 17, and 18 to 1F. This constitutes the register bank. For example, we know that we have registers R0 to R7, general purpose registers. Here, R0 occupies the address 00, R1 occupies 01. R2 occupies the address 2, R3, 4, 5, 6 and 7, R4, R5 and R6, sorry, R0, R1, R2, R3. So this address, that is 00 to 07, forms the register bank 0, RB0. This is RB0. Similarly, we have R0 to R7 in the address range from 08 to 0F. That means R0 will have 08, R1 will have 09, and so up to 0F. This constitutes the address ranging from 08 to 0F constitutes the register bank 1. The next register bank, that is the address ranging from 10 to 17, 10 to 17. In that case, R0 constitutes 10, R1 constitutes 11, 12, and so on up to 17. The register bank 2 will have the address of RAM ranging from 10 to 17. Similarly, the register bank 3 occupies the address, the next address, that is 17. After 17, you will get 18 to 1F. This 8 address constitutes the register bank 3. Each will have R0 to R7. R0 to R7. The naming of registers will not change. R0 to R7. The naming will not change. There is one reason why the naming will not change. In this case, at a time, you can use only one register bank. At a time, you can choose only one register bank. In order to, you can also switch over from one register bank to the other bank using the PSW register, PSW program status word. There you have PSW.3 pin and PSW.4 pin. By giving different values, you can give 00, 01, 10 and 11. This is PSW.4, PSW.3. So if you give PSW.4 as 0 and PSW.3 0, then it will choose the register bank 0. If you give RS1 as 0 and RS0 as 1, then it will choose register bank 1, and so on. 10 bank 2, 11 bank 3. This is how you can choose this. In the program, you can shift from one register bank to the other register bank by just changing the values of PSW bit 4 and bit 3. Based on that, you can switch over from one register bank to the other register bank. But one thing that we need to note here is that we can use only one set of registers. You can use only any one of these banks can be used at a time. Next, from 20 to 2F, the 16 byte locations. We have 16 byte locations. It is called as bit addressable area. So in case of bit addressable area, we have 16 bytes. The address ranging from 20, 21, 22 up to 2F. Total 16 byte address. The 16 byte address will be used as bit addressable. Total we can address up to 128 bits. So what is the importance of bit addressable? For example, what happens is there are two types, byte addressable and bit addressable. So in case of byte addressable, let us assume that one of the address here, the 30H, this 30H is byte addressable. So let us assume that 30H is byte addressable. Okay, if 30H is byte addressable, that means that you if you want to write, for example, if you want to load the value to 30H memory location, then you need to load the entire 8 bits at a time. For example, if for 30H, if you want to load, if you want to change the last bit, there in the 30H you will have 0th bit, 1st bit, 2nd bit, 3rd bit, 4, 5, 6 and 7. So in this case, let us assume that you need to change this bit to 1, rest of them as 0. Okay. So let us assume that we need to load 0, 4H. We want to store 0, 4H data in the address 30H. In this case, you need to move, you need to use the instruction, or you need to load the entire 0, 4H into the 30H location. The advantage of bit addressing, what happens is, we know that we have discussed in our computer organization that for each bit, in order to store each bit, we will have one latch. We have already discussed about the internal configurations in the previous semester COA, where we had discussed about the memory cells. In the memory cell, each bit will have, in order to store each bit, we will have one memory cell. So in this case, when you are loading the data in terms of byte, you are wasting the power, because in this case you need to change only this particular bit. Rest of the bit you need not change. It remains as it is. But since it is byte addressable, you need to access all these bits. You need to reload the values to each and every cells that is present in the address 30H. Whereas in case of bit addressable, let us assume the address, some other address, that is, we will take it as 20H, somewhere here 20H. Now here, let me take the same data, 00000100. In this case, here we have 20H. This is the 20H location. This location is bit addressable. Here, if you observe clearly, you have 00010203 04 and so on up to 7F. That is 128 bits. For each bit, you will have one address. So if I say that 00, this is the address of 7th bit of address 20H. Now here, you need to clearly understand that you have two types of address here. In case of bit addressable, you have 20H is the byte address. 20H is the byte address. And these individual address what you have inside are the bit address. These are the bit address. So you can access this. See, for example here, 0001020304050607. Now this is the 0th bit and this is the 7th bit of address 20H. So now for in order to, if you want to load this value, you need not change 7th bit, you need not change 6th bit, you need not change 5th bit, you need not change 4th, 3rd, 1st and 0. You need to only change the first, the second bit. In that case, you need to use this address, bit address 02, and modify only that particular bit value. You can only modify the value that is present in the bit address 02. How it can be done? You have a special instruction for that, that is set bit instruction. There is one instruction. This we will again discuss when it comes for the instruction part in the module 2. So by using this set bit instruction, you can only there is a concept called read, write and modify. Read, write, modify. You can read the date individual bit, you can write the individual bit, or you can also modify the individual bit. So this is the advantage. Here what happens is lot of power wastage can be avoided. The power consumption, we know that in case of embedded controllers, the power is one of the major requirement. Power reduction in power is also one of the major requirement. By this, by using the bit addressable, you can access individual bit and you can read the individual bit, you can modify it, or you can write that. This is the bit addressable. And we have the general purpose RAM, that is byte addressable, from ranging from 30 to 7F. The address ranging from 30 to 7F are the general purpose RAM. It can be used for byte addressable kind of thing. Here, by using the instruction SBIT, 02H address, if you use this instruction, then the second bit of this bit address is 2, the second bit address of byte addressable memory will be set to 1. This particular bit will be set to 1. This is how a bit addressable data can be read, written or modified. This is about the internal RAM. We will discuss about the address ranging from 80 to 7F in the special function register. That will be in the next slide. Here in this slide, we will be discussing about some of the special function registers. However, we have come across what is B register, what is accumulator, we have come across PSW, instruction pointer, or P3, IE, P2, SBUF, serial buffer register, serial control registers, P1, these are the timer registers, these are timer control registers, program control registers, DPH, DPL, stack pointer, port 0. So, these are the special purpose registers. And this special purpose register holds the address of internal RAM ranging from 80 to FF. From 80 to FF, we will have the special purpose registers. Special purpose register. So total from 00 to 1F, you have register bank. From 20 to 2F, you have bit addressable. And from 30 to 7F, you have addressable RAM. From 80 to FF, you have the special purpose or the special function registers. So these special function registers, all the address ranges need not be occupied by these special purpose registers. Only few, whichever that are available, will be occupying the address in the special purpose range, that is from the 80 to FF. Here, some of the registers are bit addressable, some of the registers are byte addressable. So when I say bit addressable, here the individual register can be read, written, and modified by accessing the individual bits if it is bit addressable. So here in this, whatever the registers that are mentioned in red color, that is B accumulator, PSW, IP, P3, IE, interrupt enable, P2, SCON, P1, timer control registers, and port 0. All these are bit addressable. You can access individual bits. Other which are mentioned in black, that is SBUF. You cannot, it is not bit addressable, it is byte addressable. TH1, TH0, TL1, TL0, TMOD, timer mode register, program control register, DPH and DPL. All these registers are byte addressable. So here, while programming, you need to use this address. You need to use this address. Wherever you are using PSW, the controller will not understand what is PSW. So whenever we write the C program for embedded controllers, we will be having one include file. We will be adding one file, that is header file. In the header file, we will mention all these things. What is the address of B? What we will be defining it, defining the names of individual registers as a macro, same sort as macros. We'll mention that, and wherever you want, then you can use, for example, the port 0. Port 0 address is 80. So either you can use 80H to load the data that you want to load into port 0, or you can use the port P0. You can use P0 and load the values to the port 0, provided you have a file that in which you have already defined what is P0. Unless and until you have not defined what is P0, you cannot use the P0 directly in the keel. It will throw you an error. So there will be an header file that you have to include while writing the program. That we will come in detail when we write the when we begin with the programming part. So here, this is a B register. We have already, these are the CPU registers. They are, the address of CPU registers are E0 and F0. E0 and F0. Program status word, the address of program status word is D0. And IP, the address of IP is B8, port 3, B0. Interrupt enable pin, the address is A8. And each and every registers that are special purpose registers have its own address, such as TH1 will have 8B, TH0 will have 8C. See, here we have a data pointer register that is split into two. However, the DPTR, if you use DPTR, it will be a 16-bit register. We have already discussed. It will be split into two, DPH and DPL. So this DPH holds the higher word, higher byte, and DPL holds the lower byte. This is about the special function registers. In this slide, we will be discussing about the 8051 pin diagram. We all know that an 8051 IC is of a 40-pin IC. It has 40 pins, out of which it has 32 IO pins, which are used to communicate the microcontroller with the external circuits. Here, we have the pins starting from pin number 1 to 40. It is a dual inline package, that is dual inline package, that is DIP package, we also call it as. So it will have 20 pins each on each side. So the first pin to 8 pin, that is port 0. Here, port 1. The port 1 pin is can be configured as input as well as output. Here, the port pins, this port 1 pin is purely an IO pin. It doesn't have, these pins are not multiplexed with any other pins. It is purely input-output. And the port 1 pins will have the internal pull-up. There is an internal pull-up resistors. So you need not connect the pull-up resistors externally in case of port 1 pin. So, next, the ninth pin is the reset pin. So ninth pin is reset pin. So there is a external reset circuit. In case of the reset pin, that is pin number 9, when we give it is an active low signal. Whenever we connect it to 0, when the reset pin is connected to 0, what happens is it will reset the system. We might have seen in our mobile phones, we have a reset button. What happens is when we press that reset button, the program starts from the very first location. Similarly here, as soon as you press the reset button, or when you press, there is a circuit to reset. There is a circuit that connects to the reset pin. When you press that button over there, it resets the device. What happens is the program counter, the program, as soon as you press the reset button, it is a type of interrupt that is present in case of 8051. This PC gets reset to reset, and PC will be loaded with the initial address of 0x000. So the program starts executing from the very first location. This is in case of the reset pin. Next we have port 3. That is, we have port 3.0 here. The 8 pins we have. Port 3, unlike port 1, it is not pure I/O. It is it has multiple functions. The port 3 pins, each and every pins of port 3 has an alternate function along with the I/O operation. So here, the port 3.0 is RxD. Port 3.0 is RxD. And port 3.1 is TXD. We discussed that in case of 8051, we have a one serial port, a minimum of one serial port that is used to transfer the data between the microcontroller and the other devices serially. So it is a full duplex communication which has two pins, that is RxD and TXD. So when you communicate with the external memory or external device, even that external device will have RxD and TXD pins. So the RxD of microcontroller is connected to TXD of the other device. In turn, the TXD of the microcontroller is connected to RxD. This is how the full duplex communication works. Now, this is how the serial communication works in case of 8051 as well. Next, the port 3.2 and 3.3 are connected to INT 0 and INT 1. We have total 5 interrupts in case of 8051. We have 5 interrupts. Out of 5, 3 are internal interrupts and 2 are external hardware interrupts. When I say the external hardware interrupt, that means you can connect any sensor or any switch to the microcontroller as a interrupt. Any external hardware, if you want to grab the attention of the microcontroller, you can connect the sensors or any switch to either of these pins, port 3.2 or port 3.3. It behaves as an external interrupt. Next pins are timer 0 and timer 1, T0 and T1. That is port 3. We have port 3.4 and 3.5 that are timer 0 and timer 1. Timer 0, port 3.4, and timer 1, port 3.5. Next, we have port 3.6 and port 3.7, that is write and read. So, these write and read pins are used to interface the memory. Interface external memory. Whenever you interface the external memory, you need to give the command to the slave or the memory that is connected to the microcontroller. For example, we have connected a memory to a microcontroller. Then the microcontroller will be the master and this will be the slave. The memory will be a slave. So the master has to initiate whether it is going to write to the memory or it will read from the memory. In order to do that, we have the write pin, that is port 3.6 and port 3.7. Even in the memory, we will have a read pin and the write pin. Or there is some other pins to which these write pins are connected and the read pins are connected. This is how the read and write operation takes place in case of memory when it is interfaced to a 8051 microcontroller. This we will look into in detail in the next slide, next videos. Next we have XTAL1 and XTAL2 and XTAL1. So we have the pins XTAL2 and XTAL1. These are the pins to which the crystal oscillators are connected. So the entire microcontroller depends on the clock signal or the clock pulse that is applied at the these two pins. If the crystal oscillator doesn't work, your microcontroller will not work. Based on the pulses that is generated by the clock pulse or the crystal oscillator that is connected to XTAL2 and XTAL pin or pin number 18 or pin number 19, the crystal will be generated based on the crystal oscillator connector. Usually we will connect 11.0592 megahertz for a frequency, megahertz frequency clock generator or the crystal oscillator with the rating 11.0592 megahertz to the pins 18 and pin number 19. This will give the clock pulses. So this clock pulses are very necessary for the execution of instructions. We know that an instruction, a minimum time taken by instruction is one machine cycle. A minimum time taken for an instruction to execute is one machine cycle. One machine cycle is nothing but 12 clock pulses. If you have 12 such clock pulses, this is 1, 2, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and such 12 clock pulses we need to make it one machine cycle. So the minimum time taken by your instruction to execute is one machine cycle or the 12 clock cycles. So some of the instruction may take one machine cycle, some of the instruction may take two machine cycles, some of them may take three machine cycles. It is dependent on the instruction, but the minimum time taken is the 12 clock pulses. Without these clock pulses, no instruction will work. If no instruction work, then the 8051 is of no use at all. The next pin number is 20. This 20 is connected to ground. We have a 40th pin connected to VCC and VCC that is 5 volt, and the 20th pin is connected to ground. So we have 32 IO pins, then we have XTAL2, XTAL1, ground, VCC, total 36, plus external access, address latch enable, PSEN, and reset, total 40 pins. So now we have port 2. So here, in case of port 2, again it behaves as IO. The basic operation of port 2 is input output. So here one thing we need to note is the pin port 2.0 starts from 21. See, all the other pins starts from a lower number. Lower pin number means lower bit, whereas here 21 it goes in opposite order when you connect a chip. That you need to notice when you interface it with the controller. Any other interfacing experiments you need to consider. Here, port 2.0, here it is mentioned as A8. It behaves as a IO line as well as address bus. Port 2 behaves as IO, input output, as well as address bus. What does that mean? See here, we know that the data bus of 8051 is 8 bit. Address bus is 16 bit. Address bus is 16 bit. Here, the address bits ranging from A8 to A15 will be given by port 2. Higher order address are whenever you interface memories with microcontroller. In such cases, you need to generate the address. For example, this microcontroller is capable of interfacing 64 kilobytes of external memory. When you interface a 64 kilobytes of external memory, then the address number of address lines required is 2 power 16. That is, 16 address lines are required. 2 power 16 is 64 kilo So 16 address lines are required. Out of these 16 lines, the lower order address will be generated by port 0. Lower order address is generated by port 0 and higher order address is generated by port 2. Next important pins are PSEN and EA, external access, and PSEN. This is nothing but program store enable. External access and program store enable. We know that the microcontroller has internal ROM, which is of 4 kilobytes. In some cases, this 4 kilobytes is not sufficient enough to store the program. The program, whatever you are going to write, and the size of program, if it exceeds 4 kilobytes, you can use the external ROM to load the program as well. Either you can have a mixture of internal, you can have part of code in internal ROM and part of code in external ROM, or you can have the entire program that can be loaded into the external memory. So when you load the entire program into the external memory, then this external access pin, which is active low, EA bar we call, this has to be grounded. This EA bar pin has to be grounded when the program is stored completely in the external memory, along with the program store enable has to be made high. This program store enable has to be made high or connected to VCC, and external access pin has to be connected to ground in order to store the program in the external memory. If external access pin is not grounded, or if external access pin is connected to 1, this means that the part of the code is in internal ROM, the part of code is in external ROM. Once the internal ROM codes are executed, it next accesses the data from the external RAM. If you want to store the program, entire program, in external memory, then this external access pin has to be connected to ground. This is about the EA pin and PSEN, program store enable. The next pins what we have is address latch enable. So in case of address latch enable, here in case of 8051, the port 0 pins have both address and data, that is address bus ranging from A0 to A7 and the data ranging from D0 to D7. So both the address as well as data are multiplexed and transmitted through a port 0. In order to differentiate the address and the data, we have a signal called address latch enable, that is pin number 30. This address latch enable, what it does is it helps us to differentiate the address from the data. This is the signal that will be helping us to differentiate the address and the data. However, we'll be discussing about this in detail in next videos about interfacing the memory, various types of memory with the microcontroller. We will discuss that in detail. And however, by default, the port pins, it may be port 0, port 1, port 2 or port 3, by default it will be configured as input. The reason is, once the system is reset, all the pins will be in the logic 1 state. So these, by default, all these pins are configured as the input port. If you want to configure it as output, then you need to write 0 to the corresponding pin which you want to configure it as output. Here we end with the discussion on Venn diagram. In next videos, we will be discussing about the interfacing various types of memory with the 8051.